Hello everyone. Welcome to the topic number 4. Last classes we discussed about the chromatic aberrations and its methods for elimination or minimization of chromatic aberration. Now we will discuss about the monochromatic aberrations. That means these aberrations which are formed due to single wavelength light rays incidenting on optical system. Here, optical system means any kind of lens. In this monochromatic aberration, the first and foremost aberration is called spherical aberration. So, what is spherical aberration? The definition means it means the inability of the lens to form a point image on an axial point object is called spherical aberration. So, the spherical aberration occurs for the point objects only. In order to explain this spherical aberration, consider a lens L which is having a principal axis and optical axis. We know that the principal axis and the optical axis both are mutually perpendicular to each other. Now, consider a point object on the principal axis. Now consider the light rays incident on lens which are very near to principal axis. These light rays are called paraxial rays. Similarly, the light rays incident on lens which are very far away from the principal axis, these light rays are called marginal rays. In case if the lens is not there, then these paraxial rays and marginal rays are go straight without any deviation. But due to the presence of lens, these rays gets deviation. But we know the formula delta is equal to h by f implies delta proportional to h. Here the focal length of the convex lens f is constant, which will never gonna change. Hence delta directly proportional to h. When you observe the figure, the paraxial rays are incident on lens with a height hp from the principal axis. Similarly, the marginal rays are incident on lens with a height hm from the principal axis. Hence, hm is greater than hp. Therefore, the paraxial rays gets more deviation than marginal rays. As a result, due to higher deviation of marginal rays, these marginal rays forms an image at a point im. Similarly, due to lower deviation of paraxial rays, the paraxial rays forms an image at a point ip. The images are occur from im to ip. As a result, the image is not clear at any point in between im to ip. If we place a screen from IP to IM perpendicular to principal axis, then the image is not clear at any place. At a particular point, image is formed in a circular form. This circle is called circle of least confusion. This circle can only formed at where the paraxial and marginal rays are meeting. This image of object only forms in the shape of circle. Hence, in 3D view, this is in sphere. So that's why it is called as a spherical aberration. The spherical aberration for convex lens is always positive because the value of IP is greater than IM. But for concave lens, the spherical aberration is always negative. Why? Because the value of IM is greater than IP. If you see the animation, then you can understand why spherical aberration is negative for concave lens. Seeing the picture, that is cluster of stars on the left hand side of picture, this is original picture. But on the other hand, the right hand side picture is affected by lens which contains spherical aberration. If we see the red color circles, then we can realize what is spherical aberration. That means The image is not clear in spherical aberration. Hence, we need to study the methods for minimizing or elimination of spherical aberration. The first method is, the spherical aberration can be eliminated by using proper slits or stops. That means to stop either marginal rays or paraxial rays of lens. In this animation, if we place slits in front of lens, then only paraxial rays are incident on lens. After this, refraction takes place and forms an image at a point IP. Similarly, if you place a stop in front of lens, then only marginal rays are incident on lens. After this, refraction takes place and forms an image at a point IM. Second method, the spherical aberration for convex lens is positive and for concave lens is negative. Hence, by suitable combination of convex and concave lenses are in contact, the spherical aberration can be eliminated. Here we can see this animation so that we can realize how we can eliminate spherical aberration. Third method, the spherical aberration can be eliminated with a thin plano convex lens in such a way that the curvature of lens is facing the incident rays. Suppose if you take the plano convex lens, out of all different kind of lenses, the plano convex lens gets small deviation for the light rays and forms an image at single point on the principal axis. In this, the plano convex lens, when the light ray incident on the curvature of field, it gets less spherical aberration deviation. Fourth method, the spherical aberration can be eliminated by using with a cross lens. R1 by R2 is equal to minus 1 by 6. We know that in the convex lens it contains 2 radii of curvature. These radii are in the ratio R1 by R2 is equal to minus 1 by 6. Fifth method, separation of 2 plano convex lenses. If we use this method, then you can completely eliminate spherical aberration. This is very important. Consider a plano convex lens L1 which is having F1 focal length and also another plano convex lens L2 which is having F2 focal length. When these plano convex lenses are separated by distance D, then this system can eliminate completely spherical aberration. Consider a monochromatic light AB is incident on lens L1 at a height H1 from the principal axis. In case lens L1 is not there, then this light ray goes straight line without any deviation. But due to the lens L1, the light ray AB deviate into BC light ray and incident on lens L2. The angle of deviation of the lens L1 is delta 1. In case lens L2 is not there, then this light ray goes straight without any deviation and forms an image on the principal axis at a point F1. Consider at point C, the light ray is at a height H2. But due to lens L2, the light ray BC forms an image at a point F2. Now the angle of deviation for lens L2 is delta 2. So, the condition for complete elimination of spherical aberration is delta 1 is equal to delta 2. That means H1 by F1 is equal to H2 by F2. From the equation delta is equal to H by F. By cross multiplication, H1 by H2 is equal to F1 by F2. Assuming this is equation number 1. Here, height H1 is equal to BL1 and height H2 is equal to CL2. But from similar triangles, triangle BL1 F1 and triangle CL2 F1, we can write as a BL1 by CL2 is equal to L1 F1 divided by L2 F1. Here BL1 is equal to H1, CL2 is equal to H2, and L1 F1 means focal length of F1 for the lens L1. And also L2 F1 can be written as L1 F1 minus L1 L2. Here L1 L2 means the distance between two lenses, that is D. The above analogy values put in second equation. Hence we can write as a H1 by H2 is equal to F1 by L1 F1 minus L1 L2 is equal to F1 by F1 minus D. From 1 into H1 by H2 is equal to F1 by F2 is equal to F1 by F1 minus D implies F1 by F2 is equal to F1 by F1 minus D. Here F1 cancel each other and the numerator of the both sides. Therefore, ultimately we get F2 is equal to F1 minus D. Implies we can write as a D is equal to F1 minus F2. That means when two lenses which are separated by distance equal to the difference of their focal lengths, then this combination can eliminate spherical aberration completely. The above condition is used for the construction of Huygens eyepiece. This condition is called complete elimination of spherical aberration. So, this is our topic. So, please subscribe our Telugu Gamanam channel for more lecture videos. Click the bell icon for notifications. If you want to get lecture notes for this lecture video, click the description link below in the lecture video. Thank you for watching this video. See you again in the next lecture video. Have a nice day. Thank you one and all.